That's the clock. All right, so 6 o'clock it is. Good evening to you all. Welcome to this inaugural lecture for Professor Simon Hall. We've got here colleagues, friends, supporters, and Simon's family, Caroline, his wife, and Corey, his son, and Emily, his daughter, and Caroline's parents, who are apparently somewhere in between Weston-super-Mare and here. But I'm sure you'll give them a rapturous applause when they arrive. So Simon Hall, Professor Simon Hall is a very valued and popular colleague in our school, but most importantly, he is a leading authority on the control of crystal growth across a range of functional materials. And this is what he is known for. He specializes in the synthesis and characterization of novel materials that find uses in things such as superconductors, foodstuffs, pharmaceuticals, piezoelectrics. Simon has been at the University of Bristol since 1997, when he read for a PhD with Professor Steve Mann. Stay awake at the back, please. The title of his thesis was Template Control on the Structure of Minerals, and it was concerned with biomimetics, the study of how you can replicate biomineralization processes within a laboratory. For those of you who don't know, biomineralization is the process of deposition of minerals within living systems. After a postdoc with Steve, Simon was awarded a very prestigious Royal Society University Research Fellowship in 2004. And this fellowship enabled him to take his studies of biomimetics and to apply them in different areas, such as high temperature superconductivity. This led in 2006 to his discovery of the first synthesis of a single crystal high temperature superconducting nanowire. For his work on nanowires, he was awarded in 2015 a Nanotechnology Platform Japan Prize, awarded by the Japanese government. In the same year, he was awarded a Matsume Foundation Fellowship, one of only 12 awarded across the world in natural sciences in that year. In 2016, he was made a visiting professor of material science at Nagaoka University of Technology in Japan. And in 2018, he was made a visiting professor at Keio University in Tokyo. He is, as you would expect, a fellow of the Royal Society of Chemistry, and he was made a professor here in 2011. What did I say? Hello. Is this Caroline's parents? Hello. Come on in. We've reserved a seat for you. You've missed the jokes about your family and all the jokes about Simon. Do sit down and make yourself comfortable. You're very welcome to the Wills Building. As well as conducting his scientific research, Simon also teaches on the chemistry undergraduate program, and he takes this work very seriously, of course. In 2013, as a measure of the seriousness and ability of his teaching standards, he was made a fellow of the Higher Education Academy, and I think that's a recognition of the enthusiasm and passion that he puts into his teaching, which both staff and students recognize and is popular with across our undergraduate cohort and with our postgraduates. Today, Simon's research is focused on the control and characterization of organic crystals for pharmaceutical and optoelectric research, and on the creation of novel forms of inorganic high-temperature superconductors. He's published more than 120 papers since beginning his PhD, and he says, like all good scientists, has seen his fair share of unexpected results, as we shall no doubt hear about today. Professor Simon Hall, Simon, may I invite you to give your inaugural lecture entitled Unexpected Crystals in the Bragging Area. Thank you.
All right, lovely. Thank you very much. Thanks, Emma. That's a fantastic introduction. Where to begin? I think probably to begin at the very beginning, as the song goes. I was born, as my friends are constantly tired of me telling them, Stratford-upon-Avon, Shakespeare's country, back in 1969, so I'm a child of the 60s, technically. But very soon after, my father, who worked for Flowers Brewery, were bought by Whitbread, and there was an opening down in a little town called Tiverton in Devon, and so we all moved down there in the 1970s, very early 1970s. And from a very early age, and to borrow a line from Goodfellas, as far back as I can remember, I always wanted to be a scientist. And my sister will hate me putting that picture up because I think I look really cute there. You can see my hair's getting a bit darker. Here I am here with even lighter hair. There is Professor Steve Parker, who's actually sat here in the audience, looking slightly different. And the reason I know this is from a story my father used to tell, my dear departed father, about something that happened. This has got to be 72, 73, something like that. I'm going to shock all of the younger people in here in the audience. Back in the 70s, not only was there no internet, there were only three television channels. Can you imagine? Not only that, those three television channels closed down at about 1 o'clock in the morning because there was obviously nothing else to be doing on TV. And the Open University used that time after the close down on BBC Two to show their distance learning programs. And as my dad used to tell the story, one morning he woke up sort of 1:30 in the morning, strange sounds downstairs, and he kind of tiptoed down to see what was going on. And this is before the program started, the Open University programs, and after the television stopped, they would play this. Does that bring back memories for a lot of people? Anyway, that would go on loop for 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 50 minutes. And my dad came downstairs, found me sat 3 years old in front of this, just going round and round and round, like something out of Poltergeist. So, wow, what are you doing? And apparently I turned around to him and said, I'm going to be a scientist. So there we go, 3 years old. So one would imagine, right, from knowing what I wanted to do right from an early age to this point here now, today, that it would be a nice straight line. And I think most of my colleagues would kind of figure out that that was what happened. But of course, my family and some of my friends know that that is actually not what happened. What actually happened was went to, it's now Tivy High School, it was Tiverton Comprehensive School back then, and for whatever reason I was completely bored with schoolwork, whatever they were teaching me. I just did enough to get by, and you can see from the school reports, it's, you know, okay, I'm in A set, but very much, unfortunately, Simon has not displayed effort. I have a feeling his marks could be higher, some excellent pieces of work, but I think these days something would probably be done about that, but back then I was just left to my own devices, and I would spend the first couple of years in school not really paying attention and kind of bumbling along and just doing what was necessary. But of course you're at school for 3-4 years, and so there was still time to turn it around. The only trouble is, what happened about two-thirds of the way through my school career is that I joined a band. And there I am, by the way, that's me, the long hair, tattoo, snakeskin jeans from New Look, right? I could fit into the snakes and jeans from New Look back then. My brother's 1971 Les Paul custom guitar, most beautiful guitar ever made. And we called ourselves Inferior. This is one of those flip through a book to find a band name, because we already had a gig, but we didn't have any band names for the publicity. So I devoted all my time and energy to being in Inferior. And we played the school, we played pubs. Then we had a residency in the Blacksmith's Arms, which is one of our favorite pubs, which had to be shut down for entirely unrelated reasons. And the White Ball, and we played, and then we started playing pubs in Devon, and we were getting clubs and things. And, you know, we were, just even if I say so myself, we were quite good. For a school band, we were quite good. I mean, in fact, we were very good, because this sort of 1985 being the time of Live Aid. Somebody decided, I think it was Trevor Nunn was involved in this, decided to do like a school's version of Live Aid, call it Kids for Africa, the Kids for Africa show at the Piccadilly Theatre in London. And we were invited to be one of the acts to take part in this. And we were only sort of like 16, 15 years old at the time. And the whole point of this exercise was that we would play the Ace of Spades by Motörhead. I'm sure some of you know this. But the twist was, the exciting charity twist, was that Motörhead would then come on stage halfway through the song and mime to us playing the Ace of Spades. So this, and of course, this is way before digital photography. So there are very few photos of this, but this, I love this photo. This is me singing the Ace of Spades, and here's Lemmy on his way to scream the Ace of Spades basically into my mouth as I'm trying to sing into the microphone. But we spent the whole day with Lemmy. He's a wonderful guy, and it's such a shame he's no longer with us. But yeah, so this was where all my efforts went into. So of course, you can imagine my schoolwork took a bit of a dive. And because we were good, eventually we had a band meeting, and we decided, well, if we're ever going to make it big, we're going to have to leave Tiverton, of course, you know, small town Tiverton in Devon, and go and move to London, where, of course, the music scene is huge. Again, the kind of mindset I was in. Because I was spending so much time in the band, I had been, let's say, semi-politely asked to leave the sixth form because I was being a bit disruptive. So I'd actually taken up with a college of further education, doing business studies at this time. Also, I'd actually just started going out with a girl I was completely head over heels in love with. So I said to the band, I said, look, fine, I've got other stuff going on here. You carry on, you go off and make it big and famous. So they did that. One of them made it quite big and famous. I think the band eventually petered out after a year or two. I think they made it as far as Basingstoke rather than London. So they, right, so yeah, Tiverton to Basingstoke, not much of a thing. But the bass player, this guy here, Pete, the guy I'm stood with there, Pete Vukovic, formed this band called Three Colours Red. Some of you might have heard of it, sort of late 90s Brit rock type band. And they were fantastic, and they were on the front cover of Kerrang every week. They had a couple of appearances on Top of the Pops. Made it big. So I'm really, really proud. I'm still in touch with Pete. You know, occasionally go up to London and we have a few drinks and reminisce about the old days. But yeah, so at least one of us did make it big in the music industry. I, however, had to do something with my life. So if I wasn't in the sixth form, then I had to get a job. Fortunately, again, same as my dad with Whitbreads, and he moved down to Tiverton. Reuters, a company some of you might have heard of, they're more famous for sort of news, but they also do business and finance. They provide the sort of stock market information, and this is deliberately the sort of screen I used to have to look at, right? It's old school, Windows 3 or something. And then push the add, what was the word they used to use? Augment the information, add value to it, and then clients would buy it. So I was involved with this side of things. Of course, you know, with no A-levels, initially it was simple data entry. But I, you know, the 7 years I was there, I worked my way up to be a senior data analyst in the bond market. So I know a little bit about those. But at the same time that I joined Reuters, I instantly regretted not having a creative outlet. And of course, you know, if I'm not in the band anymore, then my first love of science comes back. And in my mind, and I think this is absolutely right, the week that I got employed with Reuters, I enrolled at the Open University. Where else? Okay, I've been indoctrinated by this thing spinning round and round and round. So I started a degree with the Open University. And for those 7 years, I would work 9 to 5, and I'd come home, and I would take up the books, and I'd teach myself chemistry and physics and maths and biology and earth science and astronomy and computer science, the new computer science that was coming out then. You name it, I was interested in it. So those 7 years were quite a febrile time, work and study and work. Over that time, I also married the girl that I was completely and utterly head over heels in love with in 1993. We had our first child, Corey, in 95. I joined for what looks to be the world's least effective superhero team there, which seemed to consist largely of wearing hats and drinking lager. And I studied and worked and I worked and I studied until 1997. I got my BSc honours degree from the Open University. Fantastic. But that was not the end of it. I had to have more. This science was consuming me. And so, as soon as I got my degree, I would go and get new scientists, because, of course, back then there was no find a PhD or jobs.ac.uk. And I would go and get new scientists, and I would look in the back for PhD positions. PhD, PhD, PhD. And one day, 19th of April, I think, 1997, there was this advert in the back of the New Scientist for a postgraduate studentship in materials chemistry with Professor Steve Mann, who, of course, was at Bath at that point. And there we go. So lots of interesting things to do here. So self-assembly, nano biomimetics, template-directed material synthesis. Fantastic. So, of course, I applied, and then we had an interview, and I remember the interviews being half talking about science and half talking about guitars, and because Steve was just getting into the guitar back then. It was brilliant, absolutely brilliant interview. And then, of course, and right at the end, he said, well, yes, okay. You sound like just the sort of person I'd like to have in my group, so come on board. And so I did. And this is what I was fascinated by. If you take calcium chloride and sodium carbonate, as pure as you can get it, mix them together in a beaker, all things being equal, you will get this beautiful crystal, calcium carbonate, or calcite. And typical for those who know crystals, it's sort of angular and it's flat and it's shiny. But of course, calcium carbonate's not always like that. Especially in nature, you find calcium carbonate that looks more like this. It's got curves, it's got little knobbly bits on, it's kind of sort of swirls and that. And yet, it's the same material, it's calcium carbonate. This is biomineralization. And so one of the things that Steve's group was doing, and the PhD that I started in on, was how to replicate this sort of thing in the lab, in a beaker, effectively. So of course, knowledge of how this happens, to be curved and knobbly and spirally and so on, allows you to apply those principles in the lab. And of course, what this does is that there are sort of soft molecules around to form little compartments in which the hard stuff grows, or their surfaces that direct the growth of the crystal from. And this is what's called, or what's known as, biomimetics. We try and mimic what nature is doing in the lab. So yeah, the PhD, and then like I said, so the first year I was at Bath, and then Steve got a chair here at Bristol, and we moved over sort of 1998, I think. And from that point on, my story to this point here is pretty much linear. It's exactly as you'd expect it to be for an academic. And by the way, I'm looking like that. I'm not bored. So I think what's happening there in my PhD is that I've double-clicked on Microsoft Excel. I'm just waiting for it to open, because you think it's bad today, right? Sorry, Microsoft, if you're watching on YouTube later. But no, you used to click on that, and the 3 minutes was not unusual at all. So I think I'm just waiting for that to happen. And then after that, as Emma said, I did a postdoc and got that Royal Society URF, and then up the ladder with the electron microscope lickety-split. So it was really the wanting to do something, or wanted to extend biomimetics into strange new areas was what sort of persuaded me to write a Royal Society URF and get it funded. And that was taking the biomimetics out of the biominerals, the sort of calcium carbonates and silicas, and applying them to materials that it had never been applied to before. And I chose this class of materials called superconductors. And they're very interesting materials. I won't go into them in great depth. But before we get there, I just thought maybe a little bit of a sort of, when I keep talking about crystals, right? So I'm conscious that we don't have scientific experts among us today. When I say crystal, this is what I mean. Or rather, I can probably broadly separate what I mean by crystals into two camps. The first we will call inorganic. These are the sort of the metal salts, and you know, in this case sodium chloride. There's also organic crystals, which are more molecular. Organic usually being the chemistry of carbon. And we can do this. We can call these things crystals because a crystal is just a regular unit that repeats with pure translational symmetry until you get a crystal, right? So you just move this unit around. So what it looks like is the case of inorganic and sodium chloride. You can see you've got sort of chlorine, sodium, all the way around like this. So that would be an ionic crystal, ions of sodium and ions of chlorine coming together. But you could also take a whole molecule. In this case, you see it's just composed of carbon and hydrogen. And this molecule is called coronene. We'll come on to coronene in a bit. And as long as you can have that regular unit that you can move around, pure translational symmetry, you can have crystals. And that's what these are, these yellow, beautiful yellow crystals of coronene. So for why we want to do this, and you know, it was all very well, the PhD, we're kind of interested in reproducing what goes on in nature, but doing it in a beaker, effectively. But if you look down the left-hand side there, you can see that crystals have applications pretty much everywhere, right? There are so many things where a crystal is required in order to have a particular function. And so one of the ways you can improve that function is by controlling or changing the way the crystals grow. So that's fundamentally what my research is all about. Can we try and alter the crystals to change the properties? And not only change them, but hopefully to augment them and make them better. So, like I said, the superconductors. Now, we don't need to know the ins and outs of exactly how these things work, but suffice to say, a superconductor is a material that, as you would imagine by the name, conducts electricity in a super way. No, it conducts electricity without resistance. So you put an electric current in a coil of a superconducting material, and it will keep going forever and ever with zero resistance, as long as you keep it cold. That's the main, they're called high temperature superconductors, but you have to cool them right down, sort of liquid nitrogen temperature, really, really low temperature, getting to minus 200 degrees C to get these things to work. And this is the one of the materials here, this black stuff here, it's called yttrium barium copper oxide, so yttrium barium copper oxide. And this particular compound, this material, works as a superconductor below a particular temperature. And you can see, as well as conducting electricity, it also nicely opposes a magnetic field, so you can have this magnetic levitation when the superconductor is cold enough. So, you know, a really interesting class of materials to want to work with. So, when I came along, this was pretty much the state of the field. We're trying to make this yttrium barium copper oxide, or sometimes we refer to it as YBCO, after the elements in there. Some other times we could call this thing Y123, because there's one yttrium, two bariums, three coppers, right? Y123, YBCO, same thing. If you try and make this, so you take some source of yttrium and barium and copper and you stick them in a crucible and you grind it up and heat it, you've got to heat it to over 900 degrees C to get the right crystal structure to form. This is what you get. You get a whole bunch of stuff which isn't what we're after. In fact, it's even worse because barium carbonate, because you've got some source of barium, and barium carbonate very quickly forms right at the start of the synthesis and stays there almost till the end. And so you've got huge chunks of barium carbonate where all the barium is locked away inside. So there's no barium available to react to form the Y123 phase. In fact, what tends to happen is you get this other phase, this Y211, which isn't superconducting, right? So it's deficient in barium and copper. So when I came on, this was the big problem. How can we stop barium carbonate from forming? Well, I think what they used to do was grind and heat, and then they cool it down, take it out, grind it, heat, really energy intensive. So I thought, could I apply what I've been doing for my PhD, controlling the way crystals grow, to a synthesis of a material like this? But it kind of sounds a bit anathema because you're having to heat this thing up to 920 degrees C. And yet I want to use some sort of bio-organic template to do it. I think, yes, it's a crazy idea, but I think that's partly why I think nobody had tried anything like this before. So one of the first things I thought about using was alginate, which is a molecule that you find a lot of alginate in seaweed. It's a very interesting molecule. Looks like this, or this is kind of a chunk of it like here. You can see very simple sort of sugar-type molecules, and they join together in two different ways. You can have this sort of a lot of M groups together, and it's nice and flat, or you can have a lot of G groups together, and you get this kind of bowl. And it's this bowl that is very interesting in terms of applying it to making a functional material, like a superconductor. Because, of course, what happens in the sea is that, and here's a very highly stylized diagram of what's going on. So what happens in the sea is that you have sodium, calcium ions in the seawater can get captured, or we would say chelation or chelated, by these groups in the alginate, in that G pocket there. And in fact, even better than that, once it's grabbed hold of one of these, another chain with another G group would come along and could sit on top. So you've kind of got like an egg box. So it's very strong for binding or coordinating or chelating, as we'd say, metal cations. So this was literally my first idea of what to try when I started my fellowship. I thought, okay, well, we'll make a solution of yttrium, barium, copper nitrate, nice precursor solution, and we will add that to a solution of a biopolymer like alginate, mix them together, stick them in the furnace, heat it up to 920, and let's see what we get. And this was my dream. This is what I thought would happen. So I thought, right, obviously, when you get above 500 degrees C, all that organic matter is going to start to burn off. It's going to start disappearing up the chimney as CO2. But before that, 500 to 400 degrees C, it's going to carbonize. So it's very carefully chelated all those metal cations. And then as the heat goes up, it forms a nice carbon coating around everything and keeps everything to the nanoscale. And things are made at the nanoscale. You can see incredibly small at the nanoscale. If you have nanoparticles of something, they're much more reactive. So I figured if we have everything at the nanoscale, when you get to 920, everything is going to react perfectly and you're going to get wonderful nanoparticles of this yttrium barium copper oxide superconductor. That was my dream. So did the first experiment, had a look on the electron microscope to see what these nanoparticles looked like, and they look like this. And they're not nanoparticles. There are some nanoparticles. You can see some little nibbly things here and there. But for the most part, these things are wires. These things are nanowires. And you can see in fact, most of the cases, they kind of start off flat and they come to a tapered end. They sort of come to a tip. Most odd. I mean, they're not the same at both ends, but there's wires. And nobody had reported a high temperature superconductor nanowire before. Weird. So unexpected, right? The first big unexpected result. So, what to do? Obviously, you get a weird and unexpected result. You have a look in the literature, see if someone's done it before, and coincidentally, around the same time as I was doing this work, this book came out by Jeff Ozin, who some of us know, on nanochemistry. So fantastic, so have a look in the book. And lo and behold, he had a chapter on complex nanowires. And he's, oh, brilliant. So it's all about simplifying complex nanowires. So here's the YBCO material that I'm making. And I just zoom into that bit. What Jeff said in his otherwise excellent book was that he said if you could make superconductors as nanowires, if you could fashion them as nanowires, then we could put them in devices, might see some new chemistry and physics, a multitude of technological opportunities. Brilliant, brilliant. However, he then goes on to say, unfortunately, YBCO cannot be made as nanowires. And then he gives a list of various methods by which you make them. Because of this avoidance of phase separation, that barium carbonate coming out in all these different phases. And also, there's no catalyst, because you normally need like a catalytic nanoparticle to make a nanowire appear. As far as Jeff's concerned, neither of these things are possible. So odd, right? So and nobody else had discussed this. I didn't really have much of a choice but to publish a paper. So I published the paper in Advanced Materials, and I think I kind of guessed, matrix, vapor, liquid, solid growth, kind of guessed at a mechanism. I said, maybe it's this way, maybe it's not that way. But still, the first high-temperature superconductor nanowire, obviously important enough to publish. And we'll come back to this again and again. And one of the reasons that I was so confident that this was the right material, this YBCO, is that you do powder X-ray diffraction, so you fire X-rays through a material, a powdered material, and you get a set of peaks like this. And every time you make this material or someone else makes this material and you fire X-rays through it, you always get the same set of peaks, all things being equal. And so you can kind of use this as a fingerprint. This is the material you've made, right? So when you have a known crystal structure, you can do this. When you have an unknown crystal structure, and we'll see that in a bit, you have to grow a whole single crystal of it and rotate it around and do diffraction. But if somebody's already done that, then you can just do the powder diffraction. There we are. So I had the right material. I had the nanowires that Jeff said couldn't exist. Published the paper. Very nice. But, and we come back to this time and again in my group, and I'm looking at all of my group here and past members of my group here. If we come up against some unexpectedness like this, we don't just brush it under the carpet. We like to know why. Why did this happen? We can't rest. We need to figure out what went on. So, as this is right at the start of my research group, so I had an excellent PhD student shared with Steve Mann, Zoe Schnepp, who's now an associate professor at Birmingham, and I asked her to get to the bottom of this, or rather with me to get to the bottom of this. So why are these things growing as nanowires and not nanoparticles? So one of the first things she did was, she said, okay, well, let's, because we can't actually see what's going on in the furnace, why don't we do the reaction, do the synthesis up to halfway, and then have a look and see what's going on. So look on the electron microscope. In fact, we did this for every 100 degrees from 300 up to 900. And this is what she saw. There they are, there are the nanoparticles, but this is at 400 degrees C. So this was kind of, again, unexpected, but the more you think about it, the more you think, this is actually, it's not nanoparticles of the superconductor. It's nanoparticles of the barium carbonate. This was the problem phase. So these are all the currents in the current bun. So you've got crystalline barium carbonate, and the rest of it is this carbonized matrix from the biopolymer, in which is contained the copper and the yttrium in a sort of poorly crystalline state. So this is what she found. And then, of course, what happens, because like I said, nanoparticles, very high energy, and they melt. They're very energetic, melt very easily, is that you turn the temperature up, and they melt. And there is your catalytic nanoparticle that Jeff was after. They melt at 811 degrees C, and then you get mass transport of the yttrium and the copper. And this particle sort of detaches and grows out. And, of course, as it's growing, it's consumed. And this YBCO nanowire forms, and it comes to a point. Brilliant, brilliant piece of work from Zoe. So again, we published that in Advanced Materials. And of course, over the years, then we can work on YBCO, because we're interested in, alginate is the only thing? No, we can do chitosan, we can do xanthan gum, starch, you name it. And a few years after this, I had another student, PhD student, Becky Boston, who's now an associate professor at Sheffield, working on a slightly different source of carbon. And she did exactly the same as Zoe did, and she stopped the thing halfway and up we go. And she was getting results like this. Now, these things, these nanowires, they've got kind of faceted ends, or they are completely flat, absolutely flat at the end. So clearly, if there is some sort of quasi-catalytic nanoparticle, it's not detaching and getting consumed, right? Because that's, you get points. These things are flat. So again, we worried about this. We don't sort of brush the results under the carpet. We worry about this. We try and get to the bottom of this. And of course, by this time, Zoe had got an international visiting fellowship in Tsukuba in Japan. And they had an electron microscope there that not only had a camera, it also had an in-situ furnace. And so Becky went, when is this? June, yeah, June 2013. And she prepared these current bun samples and took them over to Japan and watched as the nanoparticles would melt and stay perfectly embedded within this carbon matrix. And it's purely because the carbon matrix was more dense in the way that Becky prepared it than the way that Zoe originally prepared it. So these things would stay rooted in the matrix and then everything else would kind of flow through them, which explained why you have these things flat at the end. I mean, we could even explain why, you know, you get two of these nanoparticles will melt kind of joined together. So as they're growing, you get like a stepped edge. Also why some of them grew fatter because the particle would break down and push its way out through a bit of the matrix. Brilliant, absolutely fantastic work. And again, if I remember this rightly, and I think I do, we were very pleased with this, and so we're writing yet another advanced materials article about it in June. But I'd just been invited to talk about my work with nanowires at a colloquium in University of Turin. And this is in October, and I showed the results. This small colloquium, in fact, it was in the actual room there. And I showed the results to, there's only about 10 or 12 people there. Including the video, and one of them at the end got up and he said, 20 years ago I wrote a review article on all the ways that nanowires can grow, all the mechanisms, and he said, and since that time, every single one of those mechanisms has been observed except one, the microcrucible mechanism. He said, and you've just shown me a video of it. So that was, okay, so we hadn't really realised the import of what we'd got. So of course this isn't unexpected, but it's sort of a good lesson of going out and talking about your work to people, right, as widely as possible. And so as a result of us knowing that it was actually worth something, we got it published in Science in 2014. So Science and Nature are the two big journals that everyone fights to get into. So this was a really, really nice piece of work, really well appreciated by all the attendees at this. We spent most of the time drinking coffee, I think, in Turin. And over the years, I've got 23 papers I've had on just on the YBCO material. You know, we've grown the wires differently. We've grown them thicker. We've grown them thinner, longer, shorter. this is some of Becky's work. We've made spheres of them. We've got sort of millimeter arrays, sort of highly porous arrays of them. We've even got David Green, who did a PhD with me. He's now assistant professor at the University in Sweden. Said, well, starch, we could do starch, so we did starch. He said, well, pasta's basically starch, so let's try pasta. So we have a paper with macaroni and fusilli superconductors. And of course, David being David, went out and got skull and crossbone shaped pasta. So we've got skull and crossbone shaped superconductors. I mean, kind of nutty, but it's kind of nice, generated a bit of media. It just goes to show about, you know, what we can do by way of controlling shape at every length scale in these high-temperature superconductors. In fact, David did this work as well on a slightly more complicated superconductor than YBCO, this bismuth strontium calcium copper oxide. We call it BISCO, or Bi2212 after the stoichiometry. And he showed in this paper quite beautifully, if you just do the heat and beat, the grindy heat-up synthesis, and you're after this, so the X-ray, you're after all of these stars, these peaks, if you do it without any sort of control with the polyculation and the carbonization, you get the same old heap of garbage that you would get all these phases. But if you do it the way that we invented using a biotemplate, a biopolymer to keep everything, keep the reactive phase at the nanoscale, you get a decent purity of the target material. Really, really nice piece of work. In fact, speaking of chelation, because he's here in the audience tonight, Dr. Avinash Patil, he's over there, came up with this great idea of doing chelation, but using an ionic liquid. So like an ionic solid, like sodium, chlorine, you can have two ions here. This is 1-ethyl-3-methylimidazolium acetate, but that's not important. Basically, you have two, you have a positive and a negative, and they, like a salt, they want to come together and crystallize, except they're not the right shape to fit together, so you have this close association, but there's lots of degrees of freedom. So they remain a liquid. So, like, you know, if you want sodium chloride to be liquid, you have to heat it up over 800 degrees C. This stuff is a liquid at room temperature. So it's very, very stable. And you could do a lot of work with this. And what people used to do was use it as a sort of template to stop things from growing too big, binary oxide. But with Avinash and with Andy, who sat there in the front, we came up with this idea of applying this sort of chelation that we were doing with the superconductors and the biopolymers to a whole range of functional materials. I mean, this advanced materials paper, still one of my most favorite papers, not least of which because the beautiful trompe l'oeil front cover that you see here, but because we tried everything, or rather we tried as much as we thought we could. So superconductors, semiconductors, piezoelectrics, there's phosphors in there, giant magnetoresistive materials, and you can see from doing the x-ray, the powder x-ray, looking at the fingerprint patterns, with a decent level of purity. Even, and my group will know this, my go-to weird element is dysprosium. I always suggest dysprosium because nobody works with dysprosium. We even made dysprosium titanate, which is something Andy was working on with, I think it was making titanates, for like highly porous titanates. Right, and we made this material, this strange material in high purity. Turns out, of course, it's very good for absorbing neutrons. And so in a subsequent piece of work, we took it to a nuclear reactor and we tested its ability to absorb neutrons. So it can be used, this material now can be used as a control rod, or you put it in a nuclear waste to kind of make the nuclear waste a little bit safer. Polychelation, chelation, coordination, carbonization. So that's the inorganic side of what my research career has been to date. More recently, as Emma said, I've been looking at organic molecules, rather organic crystals. And this all came about with Dr. Jason Pottercree, who's sat there. We're interested in this particular molecule called coronene. And those of you who know the good old benzene molecule, it's actually six benzenes joined together in a ring. So they used to call it superbenzene or something like that. It's a very strange molecule because when you apply a magnetic field to it, you get these kind of contra-rotatory ring currents. The electrons kind of zip around in this molecule. And people have used this, I think maybe this is more my brother's field here, in computer modeling of graphene, because graphene is this sort of infinite single layer, single thick carbon layer. But a molecule of coronene, you can see from the space filling model there, kind of resembles a little chunk of graphene, this little kind of thing. And I think that was a very easy thing for computer modelers to simulate. And the other reason they use it, of course, is because everybody knew everything about coronene. Everyone understood it, its behavior, how it crystallized, everything. So I think, and Jason, we'll talk afterwards, because this is where my memory gets a little hazy, but I think I'd had a crazy idea of doping crystals of coronene with something, and we were going to apply a magnetic field and look to see if it was superconducting or something like that. But of course, all the crystals we got of coronene are kind of these sort of thin, wispy, yellow, crystally fibers. So of course, when you want to do proper put electrodes on these things and drive them, you have to have a big crystal. So I said to Jason, and he will correct me if I'm wrong, I know he will. I said to Jason, can you try and grow some coronene in the presence of a very high magnetic field and see if this makes any difference to where the crystals grow? So I'm going to use the word borrowed. We went over to physics and we borrowed a pole piece to do this in, but we'll come to that in a sec. This is coronene, right? These are the crystals in nature. And it actually grows in two or three different places in the world. It's associated with hydrocarbons, obviously. It's a polyaromatic hydrocarbon, we'd say. It's just comprised of carbon and hydrogen. And these crystals, beautiful crystals, grow out embedded in quartz. In nature, coronine crystals are called carpathite or carpatite after the Carpathian Mountains from whence they were first discovered. And they're very easy to mine for. You don't even have to go down and mine them. They sort of appear in sort of escarpments and rock faces. You go at night with a big UV lamp and you walk around like this and they fluoresce really strongly. This beautiful, characteristic blue fluorescence of coronine. So very easy to sort of pick them up off the ground and harvest them. So, as I said, we were trying to grow these things. And there was a little bit of a problem. I think we were aware of this at the start. So one of the first things Jason did was to do some digging into the structure of coronine, the crystals, and found out that they always crystallize like this. You can see this is basically one coronine molecule on top of another. And if you look from above, you can see they're not really sat very central, but this is how every single crystal of coronine grew. If you do the sort of work my brother, Professor Steve Parker, does, you see that in actual fact, the lowest energy that these two coronine molecules would sit is like this. And you can see the sort of like the green one, that's exactly in the middle and exactly in the middle of the blue, and the blue is exactly in the middle of green. So this is the sort of lowest energy form. So one might expect all crystals of coronine to look like this, but they don't. They look like this. So of course this bugged us, as it does. But anyway, so I was asking Jason to grow big crystals of this so we could dope them and do something with it. So we were mindful of this, but it wasn't sort of occupying us entirely. I need to explain something first. Polymorphism. This and this, if you get a crystal of that, looks like that. If you get a crystal of this, which doesn't exist, looks like that. We call those two things different polymorphs. So it's sort of many shape, if you like. So you can have the same molecule growing the same sort of crystal, but if they're arranged differently, they're different polymorphs. And like I said right at the start, if you change the way a crystal grows, you change the properties, okay? So this is polymorphism. So mark that word and mark it well. As basically, what you've just seen there in that simulation of moving those two rings over each other. You can either have one form, whether like that, or another form like that. You can have other things. If you add other things to a crystal, you can have salts and solvates and a co-crystal. But what we're interested in here is just the molecules themselves arranged in different ways. And this is what this appears to show. So this appears in nature. This doesn't appear in nature. Only appears in a computer simulation. Okay, anyway, so, like I said, I asked Jason to go and borrow a pole piece from an old magnetometer in physics. We did take it back, I think. If there are any physicists watching, we will take it back if we haven't taken it back already. And basically, so Jason made a nice magnetic cavity to try and whatever we were trying to do, slow down the crystals, speed up, I don't know what we're trying to do, and grow coronine from cooling a supersaturated solution, very slow cooling. And lo and behold, these enormous crystals grew. So brilliant success. Trouble was, when you analyze them, they don't behave like coronine. So you can see these are beautiful big orange blades, as opposed to, you just about see them there, kind of spindly yellow, typical crystals of coronine. And under fluorescence, they're kind of orange rather than that characteristic green fluorescence that we saw of coronine. So interesting. So we published this result. So we think, and it turned out to be a completely new polymorph. And moreover than that, it was that polymorph that people were looking for from that simulation. It was the lowest energy polymorph for coronine. And this is some work Jason did. And you can basically see, if you imagine this, these are sort of two rings moving around over each other. If you think of the red as the sort of high level, the hills, and you can slide down the hill to the blue. The blue is the sort of valley, so that's the lowest energy part. And he plotted where the normal coronine is, sort of about there, and the new form, which looks exactly like what the computer simulator people were doing, sits nicely down in this gap. So of course, a new polymorph, this time we knew that we had something significant. So we get to name the polymorph and we called it beta coronine. I mean, not because it's the second coronine that we found, right, or anyone had found, because of a particular way, I'll show you in a minute. I'll show you a slide in a minute why we called it that. Of course, we had to then rename coronine as gamma coronine. That's a gamma, by the way. Doesn't come out very well. So we had to decide what the names were. And I think for whatever reason, because they're not variables, we didn't italicize them. And then everyone who published subsequently italicized it. We used to get angry, but we don't get angry anymore. We just let them publish on it. But this is why we called it beta coronine, because there's a particular arrangement. We have arrangement of molecules in a crystal, like a herringbone pattern. And there's a very famous scientist called Desiraju who wrote a paper on, here are all the different ways you can organize molecules in a crystal. And he called this particular arrangement, where you have the rings almost 90 degrees to each other, sort of edge to face interaction, he called that the gamma herringbone structure. And where you have this more sort of like flattened angle, he called that the beta herringbone structure. So that's why we called it beta. It's like not, you know, it's not because we don't have any imagination, it was the second crystal. That's why. So we're following Desiraju's rules. But of course, we couldn't do powder x-ray on this, but because nobody had grown a crystal of it before. So what we had to do with Jason's massive orange blades was to do single crystal x-ray diffraction. So you grow a big enough single crystal, put it in there, and then you fire the x-rays at it, and it moves the crystal around in all sorts of orientations in 3D. And when it gathers all the diffraction patterns together and it says, right, here is where your atoms are. So that's the only way so far in this talk that you could do this. Of course, once you've done that, you can then take this crystal structure and you can simulate what that would look like as a powder x-ray pattern. So once we got that, once we got the single crystal, perfectly fine. So then we can work on powders and we know what we've got. We've either got this beta form or this gamma form. And again, it's not an unexpected result, but it's the sort of, I don't want to trash anyone here. It's sort of the lack of rigor that we see for time and again in science. You know, we would, and here basically is one of those powder patterns. Now this is going from sort of cooling the coronine crystals down until you get to about 12 Kelvin, very cold down here. And it's just, and the X-ray powder experiment's gathering the data all the time on the way down. And we found that, as well as growing this thing in a magnetic field, if you cool down normal gamma coronine, when you get to about 100 Kelvin, it starts to spontaneously transform into this new low-energy polymorph that we discovered. Right, not surprisingly, like you're kind of like minimizing the energy of the system. And you can see there, it's a little double peak appears there, so from 100 Kelvin downwards, there's a little peak there as well. Now, since people had been cooling down coronine since the 1970s, they would often mention these weird peaks without bothering about them. They would sweep them under the carpet. It used to drive us insane. But anyway, so I think, did we put this in a paper? We said this explains some of the strange peaks that people see in the X-ray patterns of coronine. So that was kind of a nice little favor we did to science. So, you know, at least we will be rigorous if nobody else can be rigorous. Okay, right, I'm sorry about it, but I can't say. Anyway, so yeah, we explained the weird results that have happened since the 1970s. But did you spot something I said earlier? Right, I described coronine as having this beautiful characteristic blue fluorescence. And then when Jason discovers the beta coronine polymorph, I described normal coronine as having this beautiful characteristic green fluorescence. This, again, and I will not get angry about this, I promise, but whenever, and people, 40s is it, coronine? I can't remember. But whenever people did fluorescence on coronine crystals, they would either say that the fluorescence is blue, or it's green, or it's greeny blue. There might even have been a bluey green at one point, right? And we're looking at these two things, thinking they are not the same thing, right? I mean, it drives us mad. What if? If people, I said I wouldn't get angry, if people mentioned it at all in the papers, they would say that, oh, well, the difference in color is due to impurities. And they would leave it at that. right? Without any justification or explanation. So, of course, when we started seeing this, Jason said, well, I will test the purity of these things. So we bought some carpathite, and Jason tested the purity, and these things are just carpathite. There's nothing else in them. These crystals are pure coronene, right? Pure coronene molecules, that's it. And then equally, you know, he grew some in the lab from a powder, grew these nice crystals, and tested the purity. I think he recrystallized a batch 5 times, 10 times, getting purer and purer and purer and purer, and still, we got the same result. They were still green. So there's no impurities, people. So, of course, what is the cause? Right, we're not going to say, oh, you get bluey-green fluorescence, because we've gone too far now. Right, we're worried about this. This is a problem we need to address. So we did something I don't think anyone had done. Maybe they had done and not noticed. We took some of the naturally occurring coronene, the carpathite, and the stuff we grew in the lab, and we ran them through every characterizational technique that we know, one of which was scanning electron microscopy. And we saw this. Now this, I don't think anyone had seen this before. This is naturally occurring coronene. And when you grow coronene crystals in a lab, these beautiful yellow crystals, they're sort of blocks, they're sort of yellow fibrous needles. And here, there, sort of Jason's highlighted, this is the single crystal X-ray unit cell of coronene sits in there. Same thing sits in here. So they are, it's exactly the same crystal structure. But the difference, you can see, the difference is you have this texturing in nature. Over millions of years, these layers start to separate. You see the same sort of thing in nature. Look, mica does this as well. Clays. So there is clearly a difference here. And we had a student whose first degree was physics, Torsten Jensen, came and worked on this with us. And he said, well, you know, by having a different texture at the nanoscale, you can enable a different fluorescence pathway enough that it will change the color. And you can see here, so here's that sort of beautiful blue fluorescence of naturally occurring coronene as carpathite. And here are the green of coronene grown in the lab. And this difference is purely down to the texture at the nanoscale. Mystery solved. Love it. Absolutely love it. In fact, you know, we went one step further. We said, okay, well, if this is due to nanotexturing, if you take carpathite and you dissolve it, and recrystallize it in the lab, right, over days rather than millions of years, you're not going to have this texturing, you're going to have this, and it's going to be green, and so it was. So absolutely explained that once and for all. So that was really nice. What wasn't so nice was that we got a write-up about it in Breitbart News, which is, you know, it's not something we would ever consider reading, but I mean, you know, appreciative of publicity, no such thing as publicity, bad publicity? No. Anyway, but this sort of, I mean, Torsten, I mean, here's Torsten here in his band, Hexcut, wonderful band. Again, musicians, right? So here's Torsten. Now, he won't mind me saying that his politics were like, let's say, kind of on the left wing. And to get this written up in Breitbart News, which is kind of not on the left wing, alternately amused and horrified him, let's say, in equal measure. But anyway, that was a really nice thing. So that was the coronene. So then thinking about polymorphism and changing the way that crystals grow got me thinking about, well, could we think of something more useful than a polyaromatic hydrocarbon where you have organic crystals and the shape of them matters? And so I thought, first and foremost, pharmaceuticals, right? Because these are very important. We need to get these things growing in the right way. So I proposed and got given this Horizon 2020 grant to look at just that, controlling polymorphism, controlling crystal growth in pharmaceuticals. These are all the PIs. I think we had a few more postdocs in three different countries. Really, really nice grant, really great bunch of people. We brought in later on our friends in Pisa. I'll come on to them in a minute. Not least of which for their legendary lunches and dinners that we used to have with them, which was always very appreciated. So this was looking at pharmaceuticals and changing the way that they grow. So a very good example of polymorphism in pharmaceuticals is paracetamol. Okay? So paracetamol has four or five different polymorphs, but there are two that people know most about. This sort of form one, we'd call this monoclinic, everything's very dense. There's form two, which is a little less dense. It's a little sort of, you'd imagine in the body, this would dissolve very easily, very quickly. Unfortunately, every paracetamol you've ever had is like that and not like that, because form one, you can grow from ethanol. Form two comes out of a melt. You have to heat it up till it melts. And pharmaceutical industries just won't do that. Cost them too much money. So every paracetamol is this rather than this, which actually would be better for the company as well, because it's more easily compressible, direct compression to make the tablets. So there's that problem. Another problem is that you want to get co-crystals. You want to get two different things to crystallize together, to change the properties, sort of synergistic change. A good example is a fertilizer, urea, which kind of is very, very soluble. So when you spread it on the fields, it very easily gets washed away. So it took 10 years, but some group finally managed to co-crystallize it with this molecule here, 4-nitrophenol, to make it much less soluble. But that took a lot of work to do, because these two molecules don't want to be in the same solution at the same time. So there's that problem, co-crystallization. So one of the things that we were working on was, can we get two different molecules in a solution at the same time? And here's an anti-epilepsy drug, carbamazepine, that Jason was working on. And we thought, could we maybe scavenge for hydrogen bonds so we get a hydrogen bonding to an oxygen? And so he added phenol to this, and the way I remember it is that he took solid carbamazepine, solid phenol, and he went to get the ethanol to dissolve it in, came back, only to find it was already a liquid. Very interesting. And it turns out that this is a known behavior. It's called a deep eutectic solvent, and it's deep because the melting point is very, very, very low. So this is kind of like Avanache's ionic liquids, except we're not dealing with ions, we're dealing with molecules. So this is a really nice thing to work with. And of course, the more we looked, the more we found examples where you can have drugs that go with these hydrogen bond donors and make a liquid. And then I'm pretty sure it was Charlie who made this observation. He'll correct me if I'm wrong. That this is actually the opposite way around to an ionic liquid, because an ionic liquid is very stable, whereas what we've got is half of it is unstable. These are all unstable molecules. So if you take the lid off, the molecule starts to disappear. So what's going to happen to these crystals? They're going to have to crystallize, and quickly. So this is what we discovered, this sort of volatile deep eutectic solvent method, whereby you just literally mix two solids, they become liquid, then you expose them to them, very quickly they crystallize. Self-destruction, self-destroying crystal system. And of course, by going fast, maybe, in some cases, you can change the way the crystals grow. And we found this, I mean, again, looking at paracetamol. In fact, look at metacetamol first. Now, paracetamol is called paracetamol because of where these groups are in relation to each other. Okay? If you imagine here, sort of with your right hand holding onto that, and you look at where that OH, that hydroxy group is, it's para. Okay, so that's paracetamol. Same here, that's meta, so that's metacetamol. In the case of metacetamol, you could change the shape of the crystals. So, and that's important because in pharmaceutical industry, if you get lots of long needles, these things, they tend to clog up everything, and they have to stop their process, clean everything out, start again. But we could change the ratio, simply by changing the ratio of phenol to the drug, change the way the crystals grew. In the case of paracetamol, even more excitingly, by and large, you see, you change the ratio from 5:1 to 8:1, say, and you get form one, or this really hard to get to, form two of paracetamol. And there you can see, and when it does crystallize, you can see, again, with a fingerprint pattern, it's very, very pure. You either get one form or the other form. And this was quite significant because, like I said, normally to get form two, you'd have to heat it up and cool it down. Here, everything's happening at room temperature, on the bench at room temperature. So that's a really, really stark and interesting example of how you can control polymorphism using this method. What else did we try? Oh, hello, the clicker's gone, there we go. So again, so we tried the co-crystallization. You put two molecules in, with a donor, make them all liquid, then see what happens when the donor evaporates. And I think, I'm pretty sure this was Jason, did these, that's the urea fertilizer. We did that in seconds. You can co-crystallize one drug with another, maybe change the properties of both. So this is a really nice piece of work. We've got some patents out on this as well. We're doing some work with a couple of companies on developing this. The last thing I'll mention about the VODE system is the fact that, of course, because it's a liquid, you could do away with crystals altogether. You could actually deliver a drug in liquid form. Obviously, if it's not phenol, you want something a little bit more, nice to the body than phenol, which we can get, which we've worked on. So something like this, this drug is almost, I say completely insoluble by, in almost every organic solvent, and yet you can get 500 mg per mil by doing it in a VODES. So the potential's there, and this is something we're working on with one of the big drug companies, about can we make a liquid deliverable drug that's normally very, very insoluble. All right. This clicker's running out of battery. Oh, hello. There we go. So I mentioned my friends in Pisa, or our friends in Pisa, and they have a technique that helps us a lot because, of course, if we're growing crystals fast, they're not growing very big. So how do you grow a big enough crystal to do the single crystal X-ray experiment? Right, you can't. What these people do is they do the same thing, the diffraction, but with electrons. They use an electron microscope. And the stage tilts your sample. It could be nano-sized crystals, round and round and round and round. And they get exactly the same as you get with a single crystal, but for an infinitely small amount of material. And they're led by the incomparable Dr. Mauro Gemmi, who's also the director of the Institute. And we knew we were working with the right people because they have a little shrine to Ganesh behind the microscope. And whenever they're struggling to get a crystal to grow, they give it some chocolate. And it's like a little, it's just the sort of group we want to work with. So we went down there and we solved lots of these crystals that we were growing by the VODES method. One of the most impressive, I think, is that, we've seen paracetamol and metacetamol. There's also orthocetamol, right, that third version. Orthocetamol will not grow decent crystals, and no one has ever got a X-ray crystal structure of orthocetamol. They were all discovered, all these the paracetamols and all their isomers, back in 1893, before X-rays were discovered. And in fact, you could draw the line up to when X-ray diffraction was discovered in 1912. So orthocetamol lasted over 100 years without anyone knowing the crystal structure. And again, and this is maybe I've romanticized this in my mind, but we grew some orthocetamol out of our VODES method, took it down to Pisa, and I think they had the unit cell roughly within the first morning that they worked on it. So this was amazing. And when we published this in Angavanta, this was the first example of using this three-dimensional electron diffraction technique to solve a crystal structure that hadn't previously been solved by X-ray diffraction. So this was kind of nice. This was a big deal. Okay, so we approached the end. I heard the bell for 7, so I've been yammering on for far too long. So they say you shouldn't explain a joke, but I feel, because this is a public lecture, I thought, okay, so inaugural lecture is about, bragging about your achievements and what you've done and everything, but also because, as you've seen, we rely on this powder diffraction, this fingerprint, this ability to know what we've made. So this is why I called it the bragging area, because it was William and Lawrence Bragg who got the Nobel Prize basically for developing X-ray diffraction for solving the crystal structure. So it's kind of a nod to them. So there, I've explained the joke now, so you can all like laugh at it. Where are we now? Well, because we love to find new techniques and new ways of doing things. So we can apply these new techniques to all sorts of materials. So I'm always looking for room temperature superconductivity. That's the secret love that dare not speak its name. Although increasingly now you can, I find. So there's Rakesh at the Squid. He's looking for room temperature superconductor. We're working with ever larger and more difficult to solubilize pharmaceuticals, and Jazz has been fighting with this latest anti-cancer drug from Merck in the lab, but also things like new ways of looking at an experiment. So Michaela for the first time, is looking at how sapphires and rubies grow by literally videoing what's going on inside a furnace at 1100 degrees C in a quartz crucible, so we can see how everything melts and comes together. It's really nice. But yeah, so plenty to do. And if anyone asks us what we want to do, this is our lab motto. Roughly translates as all the meat and all the cheese. Right? We'll do everything. We want everything. We want to do everything. Okay, so that's where we are today. So we're still carrying on. It's absolutely fantastic. So anyway, we draw to the end. So this is I've had an absolute blast. I'm sorry if I've gone on far too long. I know I'm standing between you and the wine that's outside, but hey, you'll oblige me a few thank yous. So of course, thank you to Caroline, who basically enabled me to follow my dream. Right? Who when I got my first degree, let me quit a job, a very well-paid job, to come and be an impoverished PhD student. I literally couldn't have done it without you. So thank you. Of course, the cherubs there, they're down the front here, Corey and Emily. You can see no lab specs, right? This is before the days of hot safety in the lab. put your children on a lab stool, no problem. But both of them came back to Bristol. Corey did his work experience at school in my lab. Emily, here in paleontology. So obviously Bristol is the place to be. So thank you to them. Of course, Steve, thank you for taking the chance on a strange, underqualified musician with a guitar, all those years ago. And this is what we looked like in the early days. You can see Sean and May are both here. There he is. And Sebastian has joined us from Switzerland. So there he is. See, the apple never falls far from the tree. Also, it was amazing to be part of this lab. For introducing me to this fine fellow, Wataru Ogasawara, who I'll show again in a couple of slides' time. And obviously, I'm not doing this apart from the first paper or two, I'm not doing this on my own. So, my research group is very important to me. They are my work children, if you like. So from the very, very early days, way back then with, brown hair and everything, up to the present day, throwing axes at each other for Christmas parties. This was last week, was it? Out in the quad. It's been absolutely fantastic. And of course, not least of which, the undergraduate project students who come and do their final year project in my lab. I think we've had 50 of them over the years. A lot of them have carried on into science because they love what they've done in their project so much. So absolutely thank you to my research group. And come on, clicker. Not long to go now. And of course, I couldn't let this opportunity go without saying a special thank you to Jason, who was, again, musician, came to my lab, self-funded a master's degree, then came to my lab, did a PhD, then a postdoc, then another postdoc, then I think he was a senior postdoc. Best part of 10 years in my lab. Couldn't have done it without you. Absolutely couldn't have done it without you. He's now gone to industry. You can talk to him later about this incredible industry that he's in now. But from the Robin Hood, my goodness me, look at the state of us then, to Omoide Yokocho in Tokyo, rampaging around Tokyo in 2018 like a pair of beer-fueled Godzillas. That was incredible. But this is what I like best of all from my research group, is that becoming a doctor, then a professor, now I get to create doctors. I get to make people PhDs. And this is absolute joy, and it never ceases to be a joy for me to do this. From the very first one, Joshua, back in 2012, he's now a full professor, actually, in Port Harcourt, Nigeria. So, this year, Emily, who's just gone into industry, it's just incredible to shape these young minds and send them off into the world, knowing that you've done absolutely the best job that you can do to give them the best first start in a scientific or industrial career. And here is Wataru again. So Wataru is now a very big professor in Japan, and he's invited me over and over and over. I've been going to Japan every year since 2008. Obviously taking Sean and David with me from time to time. There's Sean again. You know, I've met so many amazing people there in Nagoka and in KO and in other places, but you know, Wataru's been the linchpin of all of this. So yeah, I'm eternally grateful. He was here on Friday cooking rice for my research group, for goodness sake. You know, so absolutely a pleasure to know him and all the people at Nagoka University of Technology. And here we are, we arrive at the final slide, but I've got a little bit of time to this. Of course, it's all the people who have, these erstwhile institutions who have enabled me to do my research, have funded me all these years. So I have to say thank you to them. The collaborators, the people I've collaborated with, will go on for slide after slide. But I've just summarized here the ones I've either published the most with or had the most close contact with. But again, it's the postgraduates. That's what makes this all worthwhile, right? So these are all the postgraduates that have been in my group. And we can add the 50 undergraduate project students. So I say thank you to all of these people on the slide. I say thank you to you for coming and for your attention. Thank you.
Thank you, Simon, for an absolute tour de force. That was a fantastic demonstration of your enthusiasm and brilliance in this area of supercons. So may I just thank you all for your attention. And now is the time where you get to blow the School of Chemistry's budget, because outside we have prepared, I think, for you a nice collection of things to eat and, most importantly, also things to drink. So I invite you to join us for that. And thank you very much, everyone.